You something else. We're going to do something we do at this point every week in our church. It's called taking up our tithes and offerings. It's something that we here as people at Hosanna are committed to doing. We've committed to giving back to God something that He has given to us. So if the people with the bags would pass those around now, that would be appreciated. To you, our friends, our guests, our visitors, there is no expectation that you will put anything in the bag. If you would just help us out by passing them along, we'd appreciate that. So if you would like to put something in, then thank you very much. And while that's happening, I'll pray for the offering. Father, thank you for this opportunity to give back to you something that you have given to us. Just ask you to bless what we've done and just multiply it, so that you can use it. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, it's a real celebration this morning, isn't it, when we have got something like Father's Day coming up the next week that we are going to be looking at. And that's 10:30 here. Fathers are really unique, and we're going to be honouring them in something pretty special. Honouring dads and dads-to-be. Something we all know something about. That's great. But something else to celebrate is a chance to get to know you, have a talk, a cup of tea together. We have that in those double doors at the back there, with a cold drink or a hot drink, and a chance to have a chat. I'd love to get to know you a bit better through those doors at the end of this presentation. We've got our next week's presentation of Father's Day, and that one is going to be in the morning. Remember, odd morning, we have it in the morning. Odd day, odd morning. I just thought I'd better remind you, because sometimes it looks like it's morning, then evening, but we go by the date. If it's an odd day, it's in the morning, it's an even day, then we have it in the evening. So if it's not an even evening, it's an odd morning. And that's a really good way to remember it. Well, we've been looking at drama, dance, song, and music. Now, we've seen a dive. Let's take a look at the good life and welcome on our dance team. Thank you.
then having had everything, we find these words. Get wisdom. Get understanding. Do not forget my words or swerve from them. Do not forsake wisdom, and she will protect you. Love her, and she will watch over you. Wisdom is supreme. Therefore, get wisdom. Though it cost all you have, get understanding. Esteem her, and she will exalt you. Embrace her, and she will honor you.
Come on, the jury. us come into life and if we knew what we were going to face and we knew what we were going to go through in life overall, I think a lot of us would be struggling to try and, every time the womb opened, we'd be trying to sort of block it off and say, hey, hold on, I'm not ready for life yet. I want to just take a bit more time about coming into life. You know, all of us live in a life and the unexpected things that we have happen. You know, if we knew some of the things that we know about ourselves, if we knew them ages ago, we probably wouldn't have done some of the same things we have done. We probably would have thought about what we were actually doing. We probably wouldn't have actually even looked at doing some of the things we have done. And yet, that's the reality. And this morning, we're talking about being driven. You know, what is it to be driven? What is it that drives us? What are the things that actually influence us? You know, we look at these kinds of things and we see in ourselves the weaknesses and strengths, but we don't always recognize everything about ourselves. And this morning, I want to ask this question. What fuels us? What actually drives us? What's the thing that really controls our lives? What's the thing that really is the thing that's motivating us more than anything else as individuals? And every one of us here this morning will be different. I'd like to look very briefly at some key things that appear to be driven by. Here they are. These are things that people often look at. The desire for more money, more this, more that, whatever it happens to be. The desire to look the best. Some girls around here spend ages in front of the mirror. They'd like the camera as well. Guys, don't miss out on that. Then there's the whole thing of time driving us. We have this perception that time's driving us, it's controlling us. We see popularity. I always remember that story, the time I was on Queen Street in Auckland, just after cell phones came out and the yuppie thing was all go, and this guy with this brilliantly loud tie, brand new yuppie sort of thing, cell phone in his hand, he was standing on the edge of the curb in Queen Street, and he was there so that everybody could see. You could see he was showing it off. His two mates were standing beside him, but he was making a point of making a statement that I have made it. I'm Mr. Yuppie. I've got a cell phone. They were new things in New Zealand at the time. And I was driving down the street, and as I looked at him, I thought, man, I just couldn't resist. Nobody knew who I was that day. It's Queen Street, way, way away from home. So I wound down my window, and as I went past him, I said, nice one! Boy, did he disappear quickly. You know, I thought about it afterwards. Should I have done it? Well, I don't know. Then there's other things that drive us. If it's not popularity, then often it can end up being poverty. There are people who struggle from one week to the next, and it doesn't matter how large their wages, there's a poverty. And if it's not poverty of the pocket, it's a poverty of the spirit. And then there's a social recognition thing. We see people constantly trying to climb the ladders. I remember some years ago when I accepted the invitation to become the pastor here in Porirua. One very well-to-do lady who had been very kind to us over the years stood there in a meeting with a whole lot of people all around and totally embarrassed me in some ways by the way she spoke, because she was a nice person, a person that we liked, who'd been good to us. And she said, when I announced we were coming to Porirua, she said, Porirua, don't you mean Porirua, Gary? Porirua will ruin you and you'll never climb the Baptist social ladder. Ugh. I didn't know there was a Baptist social ladder for a start, and the second thing was, if I knew where it was, I would go and chop the legs off. Now, that's the way it should be. We shouldn't be driven by those things. But that was one of the things that was happening. Low-level dreams that we have. I wanted a red one that moved, but I couldn't find a red one that moved because, you know, there's a certain organisation that believes in marketing stuff all over the country. And if you know anybody from that organisation, you'll often see stuck on the dash of their old wrecks that they're now driving a red car, usually a Mustang or some other equivalent thing, some kind of late model MG or whatever it happens to be. that they're dreaming that one day they'll have this great wealth. But they're really low-level dreams, because what actually happens in the process is that family misses out, that other things happen, agendas get all screwed up. Then what about this one? This one here drives a lot of men, but more recently, a lot of women as well. Work, 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 more work, constantly moving, constantly got to work, got to keep doing all the time. The things that drive us. Then there's the whole issue of ambition. I want to be a star. The number of people I've seen who've done this, it's particularly certain groups of people that are prone to this more than others. People who, particularly in the music industry or whatever, I want to be a star. Ambition. Rugby stars. Whatever it is, even ambition that'll drive our children, like the poor son here who was in so much stress because he wanted to play soccer and his dad had said it was a puffs game. Well, I want to make a statement here. It's not a puffs game. It's a great game and a tough game. Actually, I always thought the puffs were the ones that got down and put arms around each other, but never mind, we'll get into another. So, just teasing. What about laziness? That's a thing that drives people in today in our society. This one is driving at a higher level than when I was younger. When I was younger, the expectation was that everybody would have a job, that everybody would enjoy living with a family, have a home of their own and all the rest of it. Today, people, and I've had this said to me repetitiously, I don't want to work. Why should I work when I can go fishing and the government will pay for it? The government doesn't pay for it. I do my taxes. I object to that. I object to it strongly. Because I believe this thing that drives people, this laziness thing, is actually one of the ones that's been so insidious in our society, it's done a lot of damage. But all of them have. But you see, what actually often happens is that people try to solve those things we've just spoken about. I'll work less. I'll do this. I'll do that. I'll stop smoking. I will do. And it becomes another cycle of being driven again. That's what happens. People end up being driven. You know, every one of us faces the issues of being driven. I wonder what drives you. I wonder what secret things drive you. I wonder whether when you receive your next business card, whether you'll think of them very differently after I've told you what I'm about to tell you. You see, Al Capone had a business card. He was one of the earlier guys to actually have one. And on his business card, he was stated as being a what? A used furniture dealer. What was driving him? Certainly not furniture. The need for more. He was prepared to kill, he was prepared to murder, he was prepared to orchestrate things in society where everything revolved around him. Al Capone, the guy who was probably responsible for more deaths in Chicago and other places than any other person in his day. And his business card said he was a used furniture dealer. And really, this really shows us something about ourselves. You see, the picture we'd like to portray about ourselves is very, very different to who we really are. That's the reality. The picture we'd like to portray. So we need to ask the question, who am I? Who am I? You see, the reality is that many people never achieve great things because they refuse to see reality. They absolutely refuse to see reality. And we all do it. I remember some of the shocks in my own life in the past when something would happen and either somebody would say something or I'd become aware of the fact that I had a vulnerable point, a weakness that I had never noticed before. We assume that people know what they're doing. But if we look at ourselves, we know that we don't always know. You hear statements made sometimes in society where they'll say, oh, that person's an arrogant, da-da-da-da-da-da. You know? Do they know it? It's possible they don't. They're not even aware of who they are. So I think the thing to do for all of us sitting in this auditorium today is to say, look, I'm willing to see who I really am. I'm willing to see some reality about myself that maybe I haven't seen before. Now, these particular creative arts events that we put on here are geared specifically in the minds of most of the people in the church for those who are unchurched, who may not be part of the church yet. They're meant to give some sort of sustenance to those who are here as well, some sort of help. Well, I want to raise this morning because I want to suggest for all those that are claiming to be Christians that are here this morning, unlock the ears and the hearts, because I think this relates incredibly powerfully to every one of us in this auditorium. And don't sit there thinking, oh, that's like Aunt Mabel, or that's such and such's problem, or that's Gary's problem, or that's Jenny's problem, or name somebody else. Forget about doing that this morning. Because if you do that, you're just being Al Capone in a different way. We need to stop shooting at others. And we need, I think, to really look at who we really are this morning. So, the question I want to put to us now, how can I do better with who I am? How can I do better with who I am? Well, the first thing comes back to what I was just talking about. We need to recognize the cause of our drivenness. Recognize the cause of your drivenness. Recognize the things that are there. So what is it that's actually there? Now, last week, we talked about temperaments. We talked about the whole issue of what a temperament is. We said that the temperament is the inborn, if it'll obey me, the inborn traits that subconsciously affect the person's behaviour. And we talked about the fact that these particular ones are actually unchangeable. In other words, they really are the default settings. And they're not ones that you can change in this case. It's a preset default setting, unchangeable. Now, some people have tried to argue that they are changeable, but actually there's been substantive research done on this. And although a person might get better, they get better in terms of their temperament. So whether they're sanguine, choleric, melancholic, or phlegmatic, you know, it's there. I had a friend tell me during the week, actually I've had several people say things like this to me during the week. We're sitting there and somebody next to me says, oh, I think my dad's like that. And I've had several people make the comment, it's really funny, because they're thinking their dad's like that, and then later on they say, or their mum or whatever, whoever it happens to be in their family, and then they say, oh, I think that's me. Now, why are they doing that? What's the aspect that's there? Because we are prone to looking at the negative things first. In each one of those areas we looked at last week, there are really strong positives in each of the areas, and there's nothing wrong with any particular temperament. There's nothing wrong with it. But they're unchangeable, so we can't do anything about it. So today, you're just going to have to say, that's who I am, for those who looked at it last week. If you haven't, ask me afterwards, and I'll give you a sheet with the summary. We all have the power to live productive lives. But the reality is our personalities often should be get in the way. Not gets. Our personalities often get in the way. So we looked at last week what a personality was, and we came to this conclusion that a personality is why I act the way I do. Why I act the way that I do. That has to do with my temperament, my character, the things I've worked on. It's the way I act, why I act the way I do. And so when we look at that this morning, we also need to see what that actually means. It means two things. It means either healthy or faulty settings in our lives. And these are settings like a computer that can be changed. What's the screen that's showing on your face? What are the things that are being seen in your eyes? And if you open up the computer, how clean is the brain? Is there lots of dust in there that's causing some faulty things to happen? And I know how much that can impact you, because I remember one time, some time ago, when we were using a projector in the old days, and suddenly the whole thing crashed right in the middle of my really important event of the year. We hired the projector for this one time each year when I would do the vision statement. And in the middle of it, the whole thing went crash. And when two of our guys looked in it, they discovered near the end of my whole address, and I'd had to struggle on without the computer. Fortunately, it wasn't right. I didn't lose too much. They discovered that in there, where the RAM sits, that's the memory that gives you some random access. And when they took the card out, they found dust all the way through. They just brushed it out, shoved the card back in, and away it went. There was dust that was causing faults. And I want to suggest that the dust that causes faults for us is actually stuff that we can do something about. You know, sure, there are some healthy things about every one of us in this room. And I want to encourage those healthy things. But this morning, let's clean the dust out so that healthy things can be seen, and clearly seen, in every sense of the word. So let's have a look at some of the things that are there. You see, that the reality is that we have a thing that I'm going to call today negative mindsets that drive us. Sure, the work thing and all those things are the consequence of it, but they are only consequences of those negative mindsets. They're not actually the thing in itself that drives. And that's why so many people who try to address what they think is the problem fail to actually succeed, because they are not addressing the root cause, the real seat of the problem. I saw something on television last night, a story I thought was a rather well-told story, and I want to tell you about it. There was this guy, he was walking down a street over in the States, as it happened. He's walking down the street, and as he walked down the street, just had a bit of time to waste, he noticed a tattoo shop. Now, he was a Christian guy, so he wasn't going to go and get a tattoo, and he wasn't into that. But he was intrigued by the whole thing, so he stood and looked in the shop window, and he saw all these displays of tattoos, photographs of tattoos that had been done on people's bodies. And he was stunned when he found one of the advertised tattoos that he would have thought wouldn't have sold anything to anybody. Nobody would have bought this particular tattoo at all. Written on the arm of somebody was the word, was it arm or chest somewhere, were the words, "Born to Lose." So he's standing there pondering it at the time, thinking about it deeply, when the little Asian man who happened to be the tattooist in the shop, he came out. I think he thought he had a customer, a possible customer, and he came out the door and he had a bit of a chat with this gentleman who was looking at the shop. So the gentleman, Joel, who was looking in the shop, he sort of said to this Asian gentleman, he said, "I'm intrigued. You do a lot of tattooing," and he said, "Yes." And the Asian man said, he's been doing it for quite some years. In any case, and then Joel turned around and said to him, "I'm a little surprised that one of your tattoos advertised in your window. Born to Lose." He said, "How many people buy it?" He said, "Oh, quite a few people buy it. You know, they get it tattooed on their bodies." And Joel said, "But I can't understand. Why would somebody want to tattoo that on your body?" And the little Asian man in his wisdom said this: "Tattooed on the mind before tattooed on body." Interesting. Tattooed on mind before tattooed on body. So when we look at this, let's appreciate that we do have some things tattooed on our mind. The good thing is, and I want to say this now, there's now a method for removing tattoos. Did you know that? A laser. So, we're going to see if we can look at some and see if we can remove some this morning. The negative mindset. This I know I've called this a heading, but this is a particular individual one on its own. And some people just have a mindset, doesn't matter what happens, everything is going to be wrong. How on earth they survive at work, I've never understood. I've met people like this. They turn up on Monday morning, you say, how'd your weekend go? Oh, it was a disaster. And you really don't want to hear anymore because you know you're about to get a half hour to an hour long story about how bad the weekend was. It's so bad that you could sit there and think, man, if I had a weekend like that, I'd want to finish it. If I had a year like that, I'd want to finish it. Sort of thing. I'd want to do something about it. I'd want to stop it somehow. But there are just some people who just doesn't matter what happens, everything is bad. It's the kind of situation like the guy, a lady who went because of her husband to a counsellor. And she said to the counsellor, oh, my husband's hopeless to live with. Don't matter what happens, everything's not good. And the counsellor said, well, explain to me. And the wife said to him, well, you see, if I do something, it's not good enough. And she said, I've tried arguing with him, I've tried challenging him, I've tried to get him to understand what he needs to do, but he just doesn't get his head around it. And the counselor sat there and thought for a while and said, well, you know, have you shown him respect? How can I show him respect, she says. Well, he said to her, well, look, I'd like you to try something. So she said, well, I guess anything's worth a try. I've come here for advice. I guess I've got to try it. So the counselor said to her, well, whenever he does something for you, whenever he asks you something, just say, yes, dear. Well, that went right against her grain. She wasn't going to say yes, dear to him at all. I'm not going to say yes, dear, every time he asks me for something. She said to the counselor said, do you really want to solve your problem? And she said, well, that's why I'm here. That's why I'm paying you money. And he said, well, why would you want to pay me money if you're not prepared to deal with the problem? He said, just try it. You've got nothing to lose. So and then the lady thought, well, perhaps I haven't got anything to lose. So she went home and thought, well, in the morning I'll try it. Tonight's too much. I don't think I can do it tonight. So morning comes along and she wakes up and thinks, what have I got to do today? I've got to do my yes dear today. This is going to be my day for doing it. So in any case, she gets out of bed and says to her husband, what would you like this morning? And he said, I would love breakfast in bed. She thought, no way. There's no way I'm giving him breakfast in bed. But then she remembered it was her yes dear day. So she said, yes dear. And she said, what would you like? And he said, well, I'd like a French breakfast. And he said, I'd like my toast done on one side and not the other. Yes, dear, she says, swallowing her sort of pride as she realized what that meant. And he said, what's more, he said, I'd like my sausages done so that they're just brown on one side and they're dark on the other. She said, yes, dear, getting very apprehensive about where this is all going. And then he said, I'd like two eggs, my French breakfast. I'd like one that's boiled and one that's fried. And she said, yes, dear, getting more and more horrified as things go on. And he said, I'd like Marmite on one half of my toast and Vegemite on the other. And she said, yes, dear, her voice getting higher and higher and higher. He thought this was fun. How far can I push it, he thought. And she said, I'll go and do it now. And she fled from the bedroom. And she goes and she cooks his breakfast exactly as he had described. She brings the breakfast back into him and sticks it on the tray on the bed, asked him where he wanted it, and he told her, and she put it exactly where he wanted it. He looked a bit grumpy, squaring it up on the bed, but it was okay. It was sitting there. Then she put the plate on the little table, bed table, and he looked at it, and he shook his head. He said, "You fried the wrong blooming egg." You see, there's some people who just have a negative mindset. Doesn't matter what you do, it is not good enough. Yes, dear. Fatalism. Fatalism is where you say that whatever happens is going to happen and I can't do anything about it. That's actually a root thing that actually causes people to react in all sorts of ways. One of the things that will happen with fatalism is if the boss says, I want you to work these hours and you'll do as I say, we just say, oh, okay, because we're too scared to say anything else. And fatalism actually means that other people can actually get control of us. You may not even realize it's actually happening. Fatalism just accepts things readily. It doesn't look seriously at maybe even addressing things properly. Fatalism says, I'm going to stay in bed and be lazy every day, because if I go out and take the risk of getting a job, trying to get a job, I might get turned down again. And so I won't try, because I'll just accept my lot in life as it is. Then we have anger. Anger is a driving force that causes people to do all sorts of things. And sometimes it causes people to keep working and working and working because they're so angry at home that it's safer to be at work than to be at home. Or the anger drives them in such a way that they'd far rather spend heaps and heaps of time on the golf course, because at least with the guys on the golf course, if they upset you, you can hit the ball a little harder, even if it does go in the rough. Anger has all sorts of driving features to it. Anger is one of the things that's most destructive in terms of marriages and relationships. And sometimes the anger is very verbal and very loud, and sometimes the anger sees below the surface and people don't even realize that that's actually what's driving a person. Then we also have the failure syndrome. Doesn't matter what I do, I'm never going to succeed. That's often been sown by parents who have said to their children, you will never achieve, you will never be good enough, you will never amount to anything. And they think that that's going to inspire their child to actually beat them, to actually pass, to be successful. And it doesn't. It destroys them from inside and only makes things worse as it goes along, and that failure thing will be perpetuated in the rest of their lives unless something significant happens. Then the next one. Compulsive desires. Now there's a whole bunch of compulsive desires, everything from gambling to smoking to alcoholism to all sorts of things. Sometimes work also is a compulsive desire-driven thing rather than an anger thing. A desire to succeed, to be the best, a desire to be better than everybody else, and those compulsive desires, can I tell you this, they're actually not healthy, because they'll drive you to doing things that you'll regret doing, and in the end, your compulsive desire will stop you being the used furniture dealer and make you a killer. And that's what will happen. And there's all sorts of things that we have as compulsive desires. Pornography is our biggie in society right now. Then there's the abuses that happen out of that with children and all those kinds of yucky things that are, you know, just driven by compulsive desires that are actually really, really seriously bad for us. It won't help us to function at all well. It'll destroy any possibility of us functioning well. And then we look at this next set. Fear. This one here seems to predominate people, and they are fearful. And I come back and say, in case you think the workplace thing is driven by these only things, other things only, then fear is another one that drives people, because they're afraid to change jobs. They're afraid to challenge the boss. And I'm talking about in a right way. I'm not talking about inappropriate behavior. They're afraid to actually look at things seriously and to work through issues in a way that they should. They just simply are afraid to even walk out the back door. If we are driven by fear, then it'll paralyze us. Fear will paralyze us and cause us to be people who are not going to be able to look beyond the things that we're doing each day. It'll drive us in such a way that we will regret ever being able to attempt to do something. Because at the end of the day, we disappoint ourselves because we think, maybe I can do this. And then fear takes control and we think, I failed again. And that happens in relationships. That happens at work. It happens in relation to the way we manage time. It happens in all sorts of areas of our lives. The next one is selfishness. Where we are driven by selfishness, we are so motivated by ourselves and what we can have and what we are and what we want and what we are going to demand and what we are going to... You know this situation. I had a friend years and years ago who was really like this, and to be this guy's friend, you had to be prepared to do everything he wanted to do. And for several years, I just flowed with it. I didn't particularly worry. I had some issues myself, which made me prone to allowing people like that who were control freaks and things to do this kind of stuff to me. And I just flowed along. At the point at which I became a Christian, that changed dramatically for me. And he no longer had control. You know what happened? A really interesting thing happened. I was still seeking to be the faithful friend to him in a right way. But I was drawing some lines in the sand I'd never drawn before. He actually stopped associating with me. I didn't preach at him. We did talk about Christianity, but it was precipitated by his desire to talk to me about it at the time. But he would say, we're going to do this, and I'd say, no, I'm not, because I'm going to be at church, or I'm going to be doing this, or I'm going to be doing... And it was too much for this friend. Because when I look back at it, he was so self-centered that it never was healthy for any of us. He never had very many friends. And that's one of the reasons I was trying to be a friend to him, because I sort of was one of these sort of compassionate sort of people in a silly way. Expectations of our parents or our peers. When we're driven by these expectations, and whether it's because they're selfish or some other thing that's driving them, but when we're driven by those things and we allow those things to control our lives, at the end of the day, we will never achieve. Look at the example. He could have been the best soccer star. Tama, I recommend it to you. Rugby may not be your thing. You might be the first Beckham in New Zealand. Not that I think that that's for real, but you know what I'm saying. We can be driven by the wrong things. And when other people's expectations are driving us, whether it's the boss, whether it's our friends, whether it's our parents, whatever it is, then we have lost control and we're not in a healthy state. The last two, abuse. Abuse is one of the most powerful things I've observed in the years I was doing a lot of counselling at one stage. And abuse in different forms, whether it was sexual abuse, emotional abuse, physical abuse, they're all abuse issues. And I separated the sexual one out from the physical because although it's physical, it's one that really has predominated our society recently. And that abuse thing, when it takes control and it drives us, it makes us do things that are not healthy for us. The last one, arrogance. Difference to selfishness, although it can have a selfish element. It's just that some people have been healed in such a way by their parents that they actually don't realise they're being arrogant. They just are. And the most difficult one out of the whole group, I think, is this one in some ways. Because if a person is arrogant and they don't know they're arrogant and everybody else knows and everybody tries to tell them, they're so arrogant that they don't recognise that what the other person's saying is true because they know it's not true. That's what arrogance is all about. Well, I'd like you to look at yourself this morning. And I'd like us to tackle this whole thing so that we can actually challenge it. You see, the reality is that years ago there was a king. His name was Saul. He's told about in the Bible. And this particular king was a great king initially. He started out well. He started doing things well. But then when another guy came along, David, who rescued him as king in the first place because he took away the embarrassment of the giant Goliath. Now, King Saul was embarrassed because his soldiers couldn't beat this enemy. And the little wee boy, David, comes along. And what actually happened is that he killed Goliath and then he became a soldier in the army. And he refused to wear the armor. He was radical. He was different. David was a little guy of courage who's willing to take on anything. And so off he went. And King Saul heard these songs being sung. And the song went something like this. Saul killed his thousands, but David's killed his tens of thousands. And Saul became extremely jealous. You see, Saul had an issue. I am the king. There was a pride issue there that was driven by all sorts of things in the back of his life. And he tried to kill David. A guy who was faithful to him. David even had the opportunity on one occasion to kill him in a cave when King Saul went in to relieve himself in a cave. Boy, you wouldn't want to go hiding in caves when you know that story. And he's in the cave and David snuck up behind him very quietly and cut a little bit off the bottom of his robe. And after Saul had gone out, he says, "See, Saul, I could have killed you and I didn't. Here's a bit of your robe." And Saul felt bad about this. And he said, "I'm sorry. I won't do it again. I won't try and kill you again." But he wasn't going to ever keep to his word because he was jealous. He was driven by this jealousy. He was driven by his own fear. He was driven in all sorts of ways. So in terms of solving the problem, I have three headings, three suggestions. It goes like this. The first one is this. Is that we need to face up. We've been facing up a little bit and maybe you haven't figured anything out. You might be sitting here and saying, "Well, I haven't got any of the things that are on that list." Maybe the list's not complete, folks. Or you might be sitting there thinking, "You know, I think I've pretty much dealt with all my stuff." Well, I can give you a bit of advice. This might be helpful. Choose an enemy, a closest friend, and an associate, and ask them to describe in polite words exactly how they perceive you. That's a good way of facing up, I can tell you. They'll let you have it. Even your best friend, if you give them the opportunity, well, at that point, and you say to them, "I don't mind what you say, I'm not going to say I'm going to find it easy, but I need some help, I really want to become a better person." So you face up. I think that once you've heard what they've got to say, I think most of you will want to readily turn around and say, "God help us, no other way!" The second one is, in terms of listening to them, You then need to do what our scripture said this morning. You know, Solomon wrote this proverb. Remember what it said? Get wisdom, get understanding. Do not forget my words or swerve from them. Do not forsake wisdom and she will protect you. Love her and she will watch over you. Wisdom is supreme, therefore get wisdom. Though it costs all you have, get understanding. Esteem her and she will exalt you. Embrace her and she will honor you. I was going to come out this morning dressed in my old trousers. These are some of my old work trousers, you know. And then transform on the stage, but you get the idea. We are clothed in dirty and wrinkled clothing in some ways. And really, the reality is that we actually need to be prepared to take it off and to get rid of it. And to do that, to have a transformation of the things that are actually good. No? And that's great. My wife made me that, and I don't care what you think of it. I love it. You see? Transformation is what it's all about. And the reality is, for most of us, we don't actually get wisdom in the way that we should. We actually go searching for it in all sorts of venues and avenues and things. I was talking with a friend I've known for some years. He's one of the retail people in the area. He's a very nice, kindly gentleman. He always looks after me when I go to purchase stuff at the shop. He knows who I am. He knows I'm buying for the church, and so he always gives me trade price. Lovely fellow. Very considerate person. But I was intrigued when we were having a discussion the other day. He started talking about following the teachings of Nostradamus. I thought, what do I do with this? What actually do I do? How do I tell him that Nostradamus, fiddled with a little bit of scripture, he was into direct spiritualism, not good stuff. He was into some pretty awful stuff, Nostradamus. And most of the stuff that's written about him actually isn't true. I did a whole lot of research on the guy some years ago when we did a thing on Nostradamus here. And I'd already done some reading prior to that. Most of the prophecies that are actually written about in our Western English world they've had to be translated, of course, because he didn't speak English. They've fiddled with the words. They've not told the truth. And Nostradamus is held out as a prophetic hero when in actual fact many of his prophecies have not only not come true, but proven to be false because they had dates attached to them and things like that. And so this lovely fellow who I know is following not wisdom, but a false teaching, a false prophecy, a false life. And some people say, well, you know, I don't need to follow something to be able to live a good life. I disagree. I actually want to disagree quite strongly. I want to say, when the scripture says get wisdom, get understanding, that's actually something we need to do. When it says don't forget my words or swerve from them, I think there's actually some good advice in there. Because if our Maker made us, and He knows what we do have the potential to be, at the end of the day, the things we need to address are not always the things we think we need to address. And so, in terms of that, we then need to process change. There's a passage in the book of Romans that says this: don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone to obey him as slaves, you are slaves to the one whom you obey, whether you are slaves to things that are wrong, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to doing the right thing. That's a choice we make. It was James, who was known as a guy who was incredibly good to others, who said these words: we all stumble in many ways, all of us. If anyone is never at fault in what he says, he is a perfect man, able to keep his whole body in check. And he talks about putting bits in the mouths of horses and ships being steered by a small rudder, and how much our tongue actually does so much damage. You know, it's like a very small rudder on a ship that can steer a huge ship. With the tongue, we can praise God, our Father, and with it we can curse men who have been made in God's likeness. and we even curse ourselves. And what I'd like to suggest this morning, that we need to look at this wisdom. You see, there's two types of wisdom. There's James, who finishes it off by saying this: who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show it by his good life, by deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. You notice that song the guys did, Good Good Life, this morning? The dance? Let him show it by his good life, by deeds done in humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, and of the devil. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every kind of evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. And most of us want our lives to be like that. And I would want to suggest, for those of you who are Christians here this morning, that you need to gather a bit more wisdom. All of us do. I find it's a part of my journey. I'm on that journey. And week by week I face issues. And when you're preparing messages week after week like I am here, you can't get up here. Well, I can't. Some people might be able to, but I can't get up here and speak unless I've been through the journey. I just can't speak from the heart otherwise. And it can be rough some weeks because some of the things that I have to address, you know. Most of you come here, if you're Christians, week after week, and every now and again something really powerful happens, and in between time you block a few things, and the other times it was great to be here and you didn't need to have anything particularly. It was just great to be with God. But we need to learn to process change, all of us. And then for those of you who have visited us here this morning, the whole experience of knowing the kind of peace and the love and the power and the presence that we talked about here this morning, when we get it right, we're not mucking around stuff, not just coming to church on Sunday or any of that kind of rubbish. When we're really getting it right, when we're really getting our hearts sorted out, and we're really willing to let God have a go inside us, that means getting his wisdom, not letting his words miss us. Then what actually happens, it'll be kind of like the sea that I've got in this last picture here. All the time, the waves crash in. They break on the beach and they pull the sand out, and it self-cleanses the beach all the time. I love being by the water. I love fishing. I love sea fishing particularly. And you watch as it all moves and it comes in and out, and it's so clean. In fact, if you get a wound, you cut yourself, whatever, one of the best places to wash yourself out is to get into the salt water and really get it working on you, as long as there's no pollution nearby, like happened to a friend of mine who went surfboard riding out here in Titae Bay not so many years ago before they changed the effluent discharge thing. And he said, me and my mates, we were out there and we heard there's the best surf beach in the area, so we came down here to do some surfing, and we're out there and we're paddling along, and there's a whole lot of brown seaweed everywhere in the water. And we all got sick, and then we realised it wasn't brown seaweed. Solid hunks. We kind of like that effluent discharge sometimes. But really what God would like for every one of us here is that we would really know what it is to have that peace and that cleansing and that light and that freedom that some of us here have experienced. And it doesn't just happen like that. Some people think they come to church and they say, okay, God, forgive me and I'm going to get right and everything's going to be great. It's not as simple as that. It takes some work. I've had one or two people over the years say, oh, I tried the Christian thing and it didn't work for me. No, wrong words. They tried the Christian thing, but they didn't work for it. Big difference. Because it costs to get the best. You don't go to a shop and go in and say, look, I got $2. I want the best lounge suite in town here. They'll laugh you out of the shop. The thing that God wants us to do is say, God, I've got my whole life. Take it and do what you want with it. And that way he'll give you the best because you're giving everything. So I'm going to pray a prayer right now, and if you'd like to join me in this prayer, I'd like to invite you to do so. And at the end of it, I'm going to say, and all the people said, and if you want to say amen or I agree or whatever, just say it. Let's talk to him. God, help us to be people that are going to face up to things perhaps we haven't even realized before. Lord, to grab hold of the wisdom that you're offering to us and to allow the process of change to really happen. Father, for each one of us here, there are little things that popped into our minds. Some of them we tried to suppress, and some of them we said, yeah, maybe I need to look at that. We pray, whatever, that you'll give us the courage to see clearly the things that we need to address. And that we will become the people that carry that peace and that power with us. But first of all, we want to say sorry, God, because we haven't been listening that well to you at times. In fact, some of us here haven't been listening at all. And even some of us that have been playing around with you instead of really heeding what you're saying. Convince us and help us to really change our ways, we pray in Jesus' name. And they all said,
may have a great day.